Hi everyone, my name is Hilary Stupa and I'm a software developer with QDabra Software, and this is our Q Rules Getting Started webinar, and today I wanted to talk about publishing your Q Rules form. I hope everyone can hear me okay. If you can't, maybe just change your feedback color to something other than green. So, as usual, we're going to look at the basics of Q Rules. When you go to install Q Rules, you want to run setup.exe as an admin. In order to use Q Rules, you have to use the injector to inject your form template. Make sure you close that template first. Q Rules is code, so in InfoPath Form Services, you'll either need to admin approve your template or you'll have to publish to the sandbox. The basic logic behind Q Rules is there's a changed event on the command node that tries to do whatever it is you've told it to do. So whatever text value you've passed into that command node, the code tries to act upon. There's a success node that can help you troubleshoot. If there's any errors, we return error messages to the errors node, so that node from the Q Rules data source can help you troubleshoot. You can also add sophisticated error handling by using that node. The command field can be set with rules on other fields, rules on buttons, however you'd like. The one exception is on load rules, because rules run before code, Q Rules may not be fully initialized. So instead of using on load rules, you'd want to set those on the finished loading node in the Q Rules data source. Some commands return information to the results node. If you need to pass in form values, you'll want to use a concat formula. Otherwise, you can just type in the value box for the rule. And for InfoPath Form Services, you'll want to set post back to always on fields and buttons that execute commands. So today I want to talk about some publishing scenarios. So the one scenario is you're using Filler, or what we sometimes call InfoPath Client, and that means that your user has InfoPath installed on her machine and is going to interact with the form that way. If you aren't using any full trust commands, if your form does not have to be full trust, then it's very straightforward. You can just publish your form as if you would at any time, either to a network location or to a SharePoint library. It's just not a problem. It's very straightforward. If you're using Filler and you do have full trust commands, then you're either going to need to use some sort of an install script to install this form to your user's computer, or you're going to need to sign the form with a certificate of some kind. Your users will need to accept your code signing certificate. You can, I believe, create a code signing certificate and sign with that from your local machine. It's just a matter of you do end up with some pop-ups that your users may have a little trouble with. Generally speaking, you can work around that with user education. Another scenario is you're using SharePoint 2010, you're using InfoPath 2010, and you're using browser forms, InfoPath Form Services, IPFS. You can admin approve your template. If you're using any full trust commands, you have to admin approve your template. Full trust forms cannot be published to the sandbox. So that brings us to option number four. You're using SharePoint 2010, InfoPath 2010, IPFS, and you're publishing to the sandbox. You have to be a site collection admin to publish to the sandbox. You can have administrative privileges. You can open up central admin. If you're not a site collection admin, sandbox publish will fail. And unfortunately, you're not going to get a very good error message. It's just going to tell you that you can't open the form in the browser. We'll talk about that a little bit more. Another option would be you're using SharePoint 2010 and you've developed an InfoPath 2007 form. Maybe you're not using InfoPath 2010 on your machine, but your establishment, the place you work for, or whoever you're designing the form for is using SharePoint 2010. You can still use IPFS. It's just you have to admin approve. If you try to sandbox a InfoPath 2007 object model template, you will get an error. Another option is SharePoint 2007 and InfoPath 2007. If you're using a browser form in that scenario, the only option available to you is to admin approve. So we'll go ahead and I'm going to share out my desktop and we'll walk through some of these scenarios so that you can get a better sense of them. I'm just going to share all and give it a second to resolve here. Okay, so I've got a blank template here and I'm going to inject it with Q Rules as usual. I open up the injector. I want to talk about some of the options here in the injector and what they mean. Let me drag my template over and drop it in. Okay, so here in the injector, we've got some options. We've got InfoPath 2007 and InfoPath 2010, and we've got compatibility options. The reason for all of these options is because in the code behind that QRules is using, we're compiling different DLLs, and we inject the appropriate DLL based on the choices made here in the injector. So, for example, if you inject with the InfoPath 2007 rich client DLL, I would anticipate you would not be able to admin approve your form. Your form is going to have some commands and functionality added to it that is no longer compatible with InfoPath form services. It's okay. You can just re-inject your form template if you've made the wrong choices. Now, we try in the injector, when you drop your template here or browse to it, we try to ascertain what version of InfoPath you're using, and we default to browser compatibility. Sometimes, I don't know about you, but sometimes I make mistakes, and perhaps I've saved my template as InfoPath 2010 when, in fact, it needs to be 2007 because I'm going to be admin approving to a 2007 SharePoint site or some other thing. You can change the compatibility here and inject, and then when you reopen your form template, you can use File, Save As, or you can use the compatibility settings inside the form options to modify that. So you don't have to stick with what we decide when you drop your template in here. You're able to change that. When we inject with Rich Client, it includes the save event handler and the context change event handler. And these event handlers in InfoPath are not compatible with browser forms, and then your form can no longer be published as an IPFS-enabled template. So if you use the rich client DLLs, that's perfectly fine. You'll see in your user guide there's a lot of functionality there that's available to you in the client version. But in general, if you think you're going to want to publish to browser, just inject with the browser DLLs. So I'm going to go ahead and inject my form, and we'll say OK. And we've injected successfully. Just for the sake of completing this explanation, let me go show you here in the program files. Software. You can see we've got four folders here. Now, you'll find in your documentation, in your user guide, if you search on the phrase custom code, a link to another document that tells you how to use QRules with custom code in your form. So if you've got a scenario where you need to add additional code to your form, you can do that and still use QRules. QRules can be handling the bulk of your logic, and you can add a little additional logic for the other things you need your form to do. But you'll want to pick the appropriate QRules DLL based on your form version and based on whether you're using browser or client, which is Filler. Okay, and I just wanted to highlight that so you'd be aware of that. So back we go here to our form. We've injected it with QRules. So at this point, my form template has code. The minute I inject with QRules, my form template has code, and it has to be published in a manner that recognizes and understands that. So if I had been publishing this directly to a form library as a browser form template, now I have to admin approve or sandbox, depending on where I'm publishing to. So let's take a look at what happens if I try to sandbox and I don't have permissions. I am going to see if I can make this guy a little bit smaller so I've got a little wiggle room here. So this form has nothing in it. I just created a blank form and saved it. And what I'm going to do here is publish. Now, I'm going to publish to a SharePoint site that I'm pretty sure I'm not a site collection admin on. So hopefully we'll get an error. If I've misunderstood my permissions there, then we probably won't. So to publish to Sandbox, and oh, by the way, this means Sandbox has to be set up in your SharePoint installation. So if you've got a SharePoint admin, you'll want to check with them on that. If you are the SharePoint admin, you probably already know. MSDN and TechNet have great articles to help you get Sandbox set up, but there are things you'll need to do to make sure you've got Sandbox up and running. Sandbox in SharePoint 2010 is basically what it sounds like. It's a place where you can publish things with code, and they don't interact with anything else. They stay right there. They're right put. And so when we publish up to this library is our sandbox, and SharePoint isn't too worried about the safety level of our code. However, as I mentioned, our form can't be full trust. So here's my site that I believe I don't have site administrator, site collection admin privileges on. Hopefully I typed that URL correctly. We'll find out shortly. And we're going to walk through the rather tedious publication process. So if we're going to Sandbox, we leave this checked because we want to fill out using a browser, and we're going to publish directly to a form library. Now, of course, as we know, this has some trade-offs. If we use an admin-approved template, then we can use our template in multiple libraries. That's oftentimes very desirable. But if you're in a scenario where you only need this form template in one library, sometimes sandboxing is a great way to go, particularly if you're a site collection admin, but you do not have access to central admin for your SharePoint install. Because if you don't have access to central admin, then you're constantly dependent on somebody else uploading this template for you. And I think we all know that that can get a little challenging. I'm going to go ahead and create a new form library and use my annoying all caps there. That way I'll see it easily and delete it later. Okay, and we can see our security levels domain. So this should be publishing. Now, if I do not have site collection admin privileges, what we'll anticipate seeing here is a warning at the end that tells me that while my form is published and my library is created, my form can't be used in the browser. And indeed, if I go to that library, I won't be able to open my form in the browser. Not that I'd want to anyway, because it's a boring form. It's just a plain blank page. But the thing is we aren't able, with our QRules injection, to give you a better error experience. We've done some experimenting. We've tried a few different things to see if we could give you a better error experience. We can't. So if you are trying to publish a QRules injected form and you know for a fact that you've injected it with Browser 2010 and you know for a fact you haven't done anything to it that might make it browser incompatible in another way, then you may see this message if you aren't a site collection admin. So generally speaking, for me, if I see this, the next thing I try to do is I try to admin approve my template. And let's just look at that real quick for SharePoint 2010 in case you've never admin approved a template. So the publication process here, and I hope everybody loves the quick publish button as much as I do, but of course we can't use that because we're going to publish differently this time. I use quick publish all the time once I've published once, even for these admin approved templates. It makes things easy. So I find the publish scenario a little bit hard to understand sometimes when I walk through it and I'm publishing for admin approval. And that is because we publish as if we are publishing to SharePoint, and yet we end up actually saving our form template to a network location. So either a folder on our machine, if we're the SharePoint admin who's going to be uploading this, or possibly some file share where our SharePoint admin is going to have access. So off we go. If we're going to publish this as admin approved, we go to SharePoint Server. That's the option we take there. And this guy's going to have some defaults already in there that we're going to want to clear out. Now, we put in first the SharePoint site that we're going to be using this template on. In this case, it's my root level site. And we say next. And in this instance, instead of leaving form library selected, we're going to select administrator approved form template. And we say next. Now, this is the part where I find it a little confusing, and I've worked with other people who I think have found it confusing as well. And this is where we're basically saying, where am I going to save this template so that my admin can upload it? And it's helpful if you understand that it was designed so that two different people would be involved in this activity. You're the form designer. The anticipation is that you're probably not the SharePoint admin. You're probably not someone with access to central admin. And that's why you have this option now of selecting a location to save your template. And you can save it, again, to your local hard drive if you're the one who's going to be uploading it to SharePoint. But if you're not, it needs to be a location that your admin can access. That is, the place you upload it from must be the place it's published to. Therefore, when I open Central Admin, I have to have access to this location. I hope that makes sense. And you can see we've got here a little informational message. Basically says the server admin has to enable it. Choose a location on your computer or on a network share that your admin can access. So again, we're working on the assumption here that there's two people involved. And I am just going to save this. I already know where, so I'm not going to go browsing, but you can browse, and I'm going to call this blank test.xsn. And so here's my little test.xsn, and I'll say next. I'm not promoting any properties, and finally I say publish. Now it says my form template was published successfully. Here's my location. This is where my actual published template is. Here's my target site. This is where it needs to be admin approved to. And it says, to make the form template available for use in browsers, provide the SharePoint server administrator with the information above. So again, the assumption's being made here that we're a couple different people. So your SharePoint admin, or you, if you happen to be working in a scenario where you are the admin, I'm going to just rearrange this a little bit. I always change my screen resolution before these meetings start, and then I end up rearranging Windows a lot. So I was just checking here to make sure I wasn't a site collection admin. But if we go back here to central administration, so here's my central admin page for my site. Let's ignore my health analyzer warnings. And under general application settings, InfoPath Form Services, this is where I upload a form template. So if you aren't a SharePoint admin, this is what your admin needs to do. They need to upload the form template, and they need to activate it. So they're going to upload the form template. And again, you can see they've got the browse button here. So it needs to be someplace they've got access to. I've got all of these templates here, and I'll just say open. Okay, you can verify if you want. I hate that button because what it will do is clear out this file path and make me navigate to it again. And the good news is when you click upload, the verification process is going to run. If it fails, you'll find out then. So I'm going to go ahead and click upload. Hopefully, I'm not going to end up with any issues. Sometimes I do in some of our test sites because our test SharePoint stuff gets it gets beat up pretty badly with a bunch of developers working, publishing things, and doing whatnot. At any rate, I'll upload this, and then after it's uploaded, the first time you upload an admin-approved form template, it has to be activated to a site collection. So there's two steps. And sometimes if your SharePoint administrator hasn't worked with these before, sometimes they aren't going to know what the steps are. They're not going to know about activating. So this will help you help them in the scenarios where your SharePoint admin is not the form designer. And you can see once again we've got a message right here. It says to make it available in a site collection, activate it. And there are instructions on this in your QRules user guide too. We may not have covered SharePoint 2010. The options are pretty similar, so hopefully your SharePoint admin will be able to work through it. So here's my blank test, and now I'm going to activate it to a site collection. And this has actually selected the correct site collection for me. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it selects something else, and then you have to change it. Hopefully that's going to open. You can change it here. It's lots of clicking. I'm going to cancel. I don't have any others, and I want to use this one, so I'm just going to cancel that too, and I'll just say okay. And so now my form template is being activated. Activation only has to occur the first time. And so once your form template has been activated, then you're good to go, and in the future, all your SharePoint admin will have to do is upload the form template. Now, if I were to try to upload the same form template again right now, I'd get an error. And the reason I'd get an error is because the version is the same. So you'll want an increment version. In other words, you'll have to have published again before you upload again. At any rate, those are the general, let's look real quick, just in case you're on SharePoint 2007. If you're on SharePoint 2007 in Central Admin, here's Application Management. All the way down here is Manage Form Templates and Upload Form Template. From there, the scenarios are equivalent. So those are your options with publishing. If your form is admin approved, full trust is a breeze. You do not have to sign your form. You don't have to have a certificate. Admin approving a full trust form means all you have to change is the options under Form Options. you can simply, under security and trust, set your form to full trust there and then just have your form admin approved. So that's nice. In that scenario, you don't end up having to install. Now, if you are doing a full trust filler form and you want users to be able to install it, you can use a script for that. We've got some samples here. If I just pop it open with Notepad real quick, and I'll drag it over here. This is a Microsoft script that we reuse quite a bit. If you need an install script for a full trust form, give me a holler. I'm happy to share this with you. The only problem I've run into with this is sometimes I have to find a way to remove the href attribute from my manifest. And again, give me a holler if this is a scenario you need more information on, because I'm happy to share these things with you. I guess that's it for today. Let me pop back over to my slide. If you have suggestions for this Getting Started webinar, if there's something you would like in particular to have covered that I haven't covered, if you have a scenario that you are interested in trying with QRoles that you'd like more information on, I'd really appreciate an email on that. My email address is on this slide. If you have questions now, please feel free to ask them in the Q&A control for this live meeting. There's more information available on the products page. QRoles 4.1 is coming out very soon. It's got much better Office 365 support for InfoPath Form Services forms. The forum is here. If you haven't been there before, this one's QRoles specific. We've got videos up on our YouTube channel. So I hope everybody has a great rest of the week. If you've got any questions, just pop them into the Q&A widget. And again, if you've got suggestions or if there's any materials that I covered today that you'd like more information on, please feel free to email me. Thanks so much.